The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us join together in singing our opening hymn, God's Work Our Hands, sung to the tune of Earth and All Stars, 509. Together, grand designer of all things, the light and darkness, the sky and dry land, the vegetation, the seasons, the swarms of living creatures, creeping things and wild animals and us, all these were brought into being with a word on your lips, and it was good. Amen. And our scripture acclamation for this season is hymn number 509. God's Word is our great heritage. Verse 1.
Shall be ours for ever.
seated.
And we start again at the beginning in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning the first day. And God said, "Let there be a dome in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." So God made the dome and separated the waters that were under the dome from the waters that were above the dome, and it was so. God called the dome sky, and there was evening and there was morning the second day. And God said, "Let the waters under the sky be gathered into one place, and let the dry land appear," and it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the earth put forth vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees of every kind on earth that bear fruit with the seed in it." And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed of every kind, and trees of every kind bearing fruit with the seed in it. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening and there was morning the third day. And God said, "Let there be lights in the dome of the sky to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years, and let them be lights in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth." And it was so. God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night and the stars. God set them in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening and there was morning the fourth day. And God said, "Let the waters bring forth swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly upon the earth across the dome of the sky." And so God created the great sea monsters and every living creature that moves of every kind, with which the waters swarm, and every winged bird of every kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters and the seas, and let the birds multiply on the earth." And there was evening and there was morning the fifth day. And God said, "Let the earth bring forth living creatures of every kind, cattle and creeping things and wild animals of the earth of every kind." And it was so. God made the wild animals of the earth of every kind, and the cattle of every kind, and everything that creeps upon the ground of every kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over the wild animals of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth." So God created humankind in his image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. He blessed them, and he said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and over every living thing that moves upon the earth." God said, "See, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is upon the face of the earth and every tree with its seed and its fruit. You shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth and to every bird of the air and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has breath of life, I have given every green plant for food." And it was so. God saw everything that he had made, and indeed, it was very good. And there was evening and there was morning the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished and all the multitude. And on the seventh day, God finished the work that he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all the work that he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it, because on it God rested from all the work that he had done in creation. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Last week, my sermon felt unfinished. All my sermons feel unfinished to me. There's always more to say, and there are always better ways to say it. But last week especially, I wondered if my message needed some more discussion and more context, or it just might have sounded naive or just plain wrong. In other words, I finished my sermon last week and I immediately wanted a mulligan. And this week I'm going to take it. First, a brief review from last week. We were reflecting on the last of the Psalms. Psalm 150 ends by saying, "Everything that has breath praises the Lord." I thought this is a profound insight. Grammatically, it's not saying that everything that has breath can or should praise the Lord, as our English translations imply. But everything that has breath already is praising the Lord by the very fact of having breath, of being created, of being alive. God is being praised in the sanctuary and in heaven and on earth continually, the psalm goes on. There is a great celebration going on with sounds of all kinds, many of them melodious sounds, but also loud clanging and banging. Whether we join in or not, the praise and the celebration never ceases. So in that sermon last week, I thought about the sounds of our breath. And what if all of our sighs, our groans, our sobbing tears, or even our hateful curses were thought of as prayers in themselves? Not that they could be turned into prayers, but they are already in themselves prayers, because they reveal the condition of our spirit, and God always meets us there. Our breath itself is sacred and is already praising God, whether we fully realize it or not. But I was not trying to imply that our hateful curses are in any way good or an appropriate prayer. It's only that God is always listening. We don't get to choose when God is present. God is present. And a faithful response means that we honor the sacred presence by bringing our hurt and our hate directly to God first, so that God may heal us and heal our hearts, so that we may again see the image of God in others and also within ourselves. Sometimes this can be really difficult to affirm because, dang it, people suck. They're really horrible. The things that they say and the things that they do and how we treat each other, really, we're going to affirm that they're good? Or maybe we feel broken and flawed ourselves. Can we see the image of God in ourselves? This is, as a matter of fact, the context in which the story of creation is told. Now, I often approach the story of creation as a brand new start to God's people, like it was told in a vacuum with no context to it at all. But in fact, it was a combination of several stories told orally through the centuries, which were finally chosen to be written down when they started experiencing the exile. Now, the exile was 2,200 years after the beginning of God's people in the call of Abraham. The exile was when the nation of Israel was being conquered and utterly destroyed. All of its educated leaders were taken away from their country and brought as prisoners to live in a foreign land. And those that were left in Israel suffered immensely under the cruel conditions imposed by a very cruel people. The exile felt like the very end to the people of God, not a beginning. Think about this. When everything was going wrong, the people of God wrote down these beautiful stories of creation. They are a bold statement of faith. When evil and chaos reigned, when people were behaving at their worst, killing and pillaging a whole helpless nation, they wrote down these stories so that they, and just perhaps maybe future generations, if they survive, would know God created the world good and very good. Do you see how this goodness of creation was so very far from obvious at that time? It is only by faith that they insisted still on its goodness. In the midst of ruined crops, hunger, flooding, they remembered that in the beginning, God tamed all those wild waters and protected the land and created plants so that they would multiply and flourish, providing food for all, and it was good. In the midst of the cruelty of humankind, on full display, conquering armies, tormenting the people of God, in the midst of feeling abandoned and worthless, they remembered that God said, "Let us make humankind in our image." And it was very good. They didn't tell a story of tribal favoritism in which God created some people like them who were good and some people like the Babylonians or the Assyrians who were wicked and evil. They didn't tell a story simply to try to make themselves feel better about themselves. Their faith compelled them to tell a different story. They affirmed the goodness of all people, even their enemies, as being made in the very same image of our God. They affirmed that all of humanity, no exceptions, are all brothers and sisters, equally created with this divine image within them, and called to join in the ongoing act of creation. Now we live in different times now. But we need this story just as much. It seems so many people don't seem to be reflecting the generous goodness of God as much in their everyday interactions toward each other. We need faith to remind us of who we were created to be and who we truly always are at the core of our being. In the deep anxiety of these times, we may act selfishly. We may act out of our fear. We may promote even more fear. We may try to use whatever power that we have to get our own way. We may even lie or intimidate or steal, or we may simply just judge others and remove ourselves and try to silence all the noise. But that is not who we really are. It's just easier to divide the world up into good guys and bad guys. But faith tells us that we share a common humanity which bears that image of God. And that's not the end of the story either. God didn't just create us in God's image, but gave us the power, the privilege, and the responsibility of co-creating with God as well. God said, "Fill the earth and steward it. See, I have given you everything." The story doesn't end because the creation remains unfinished. With the start of a new day and a new week, the question remains, will we create along with God something good out of the current chaos and darkness that we experience? Declaring the image of God, or as I said last week, that everything that has breath praises the Lord, it's not enough. It's just the beginning. But it's an important beginning, an all-important beginning. With this faith, the hard work remains in creating a truly beautiful community which reflects the image of God more and more. It means looking beneath and past each other's often way too obvious sins, and by faith still declaring, I see you are still a child of God. I refuse to believe that you are irredeemable, that you are utterly wicked. You are good despite what you are doing. We don't give a free pass to sin, but neither do we compound it by separating people into good and bad, worthy and unworthy, saved or damned. We refuse to give in to the temptation to only see the speck in our neighbor's eye and not see the log in our own. Instead, we choose to find some way, some creative way, some seemingly impossible way to try to bring out some small measure of good in whatever mess we have created. We persevere in faith and prayer, and we never give up because we live by the hope and the promise that we were indeed created for better than this. Everything that breathes, praise the Lord. Everything that breathes, praise the Lord. So I heard a story on a podcast this week about a man who showed up every night in front of the White House holding a candle in protest. A reporter asked the man, "Do you really think that you're standing here every night is going to make any difference? It's going to change anything? Do you really think that those in power are going to change their minds just because you're standing here?" The man responded, "I'm not trying to change them. I'm out here every night with my candle so that they don't change me, so that I don't stop caring." The sermon, all sermons, creation itself remains unfinished. It's up to us to continue to remember in whose image we are created. And whether or not we will continue to recommit ourselves to bringing good out of chaos and evil. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us sing together, "Let All Things Now Living," verse 1. Attack!
The church, the world, and all who are in need into God's loving care, responding, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Renew our nation in the ways of justice and peace. Guide those who make and administer our laws to build a society based on trust and respect. Erase prejudices that oppress. Free us from crime and violence. And guard the heart of our youth. Give all citizens a new vision for the life of harmony. Lord, in your mercy, strengthen this congregation in its work and worship, especially as we celebrate God's Work Our Hands Sunday across the ELCA. Fill our hearts with your self-giving love, that our voices may speak your praise and our lives may conform to the image of your Son. Nourish us with your word and sacraments, that we may faithfully minister in your name and witness to your love and grace for all the world. Lord, in your mercy, look with compassion on all who suffer. Support with your love those with incurable and stigmatized diseases, those unjustly imprisoned, those denied dignity, those who live without hope, those who are homeless or abandoned. As you have moved toward us in love, so lead us to be present with them in their suffering. In the name of Jesus Christ, Lord, in your mercy, and sustain those among us who need your healing touch now more than ever. Make the sick whole. We pray especially for Norm, Beth, Jerry, Robert, Brad, Ann, Hal, Sherry, and all those suffering with COVID. Sydney, Gary, Charlotte, Eleanor, Lance, Riley, and Clarkin. Give hope to the dying. Comfort those who mourn, especially the families of Lois and the family and friends of Addie. Uphold all who suffer in body or mind, not only those we know and love, but also those known only to you, that they may know the peace and joy of your supporting care. Lord, in your mercy, O God, in your loving purpose, answer all our prayers and fulfill our hopes in all things for which we pray. Give us the will to seek to bring them about for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, most loving Father, for the dear gift of your Son, who showed us what unconditional love looks like. For even in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and he gave thanks. And he broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and he gave thanks and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And our Lord has invited us to join together in praying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Know the grace and the love of Christ is for you, and come, receive it into your life. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. And now we depart singing hymn number 824, This Is My Father's World.
Sings and round me rings the music. To God.